Hello, I'm John Furrier with theCUBE. We are here in Seattle at the AWS headquarters at reInvent, getting a preview for reInvent and all the action and all the news. And we have Marc Brooker here, VP and distinguished engineer, worked on a lot of the core projects on AWS, all those core building blocks and higher level services, and has a unique perspective into the agentic future. And we'll do a little bit of preview of reInvent. Marc, great to have you. Thanks for allowing me to come into the home office here. That's right. A home game for you and an away game from theCUBE.
Yeah, well, great to meet you, and just super excited to be talking about this, this agentic stuff today.
You've had visibility into a lot of the core AWS services, Lambda and others, database. Swami's been on multiple times talking about some of the greatness around how it's evolved. And it's really kind of we're in a position now where the agentic wave and the hype is super high, but there is meat on the bone. There is low hanging fruit, things are getting done. We're expecting some big news at reInvent, but I want to get into some of the core things that you see that people should know about on the engineering and market side, as connecting the dots between how all the cloud services connect to the agentic, but we're talking about data. Data feeding into large scale infrastructure, pumping out tokens, connecting workflows, Kiro's shipping. So there's a lot of things rolling out. What's your take on this this agent wave relative to deploying them, scaling them?
Yeah, so there are two big things going on here. One of them is, you know, building agents locally, building an agent on my laptop has become very accessible to normal developers. It's no longer something that requires a lot of science expertise. If you pick up an SDK like Strands, you build with an IDE like Kiro, building an agent is very accessible. And you know, even for people without, you know, traditional software development skills, right? You can build an agent in this vibe coding mode of kind of line by line, requirement by requirement. And then, you know, how do I get that into production? How do I get that into the cloud where I can run it at scale? I can run it across my whole enterprise. I can govern it, secure it, and so on. And then potentially, most importantly, how do I get it connected to all of that data in my enterprise, right? All of those documents, all of those videos, you know, all of the stuff that we've been building up, right? Our common data estate, this huge asset that we have. How do I attach agents to that so I can make that both the agents more powerful and make that data more accessible? And so that's the second big story.
Demystify the agent, because certainly there's people saying, hey, I'm building an agent, but is it really an agent? What is an agent? And demystify that piece, because they're all being fed by the data. In some cases, there's an AI approach with models. Models are involved. Sometimes they can just be coded. Demystify, what is an agent in AWS? What does that mean?
Well, in some sense, it doesn't matter. Right. Yeah. If I'm getting things done for my business, I'm getting things done with technology, the definition isn't particularly important. But when I think about AI agents, I think, you know, an AI agent is a piece of technology, a piece of code that I can give a goal to. And it can work with a set of tools, ways of accessing data, and an AI model to work towards that goal, discover the data it knows, learn the things it needs to do, have the effects on the world it needs to have, and then get to that goal that I explained to it. The difference there with fixed function software, like, you know, the old mode of building software, is there I would have to say, here's exactly how you get to that mode. Here's an explicit workflow. Here are the lines of code or the step functions or whatever. With agents, we're using AI models to do that planning, to figure out that path to achieving the goals. And that means you can give them more open-ended goals and you can give them, you know, more autonomy to go off and discover things and find facts and bring them together.
So back in the old days, when I first used Amazon in 2007, when it just started, 2008, 2007, it was really easy. I didn't want to buy a server. They didn't have custom domains at that time. I think I was talking to Dave Brown about it. I think it was just long strings as at EC2. It was very simple. I knew what to do. I didn't want to buy a server. I just put the stuff on EC2 and S3, and they had queuing. The basic building blocks were there. I kind of understood it. For agents, there's so much going on at AWS. What is the infrastructure playbook? Do I just go in and do EC2? Is there a console? How do I start doing agents? What's the metaphor equivalent of EC2 and using storage and compute? Is there an infrastructure stand-up for people to start doing if they have stuff already out there?
So AgentCore is the core of that picture, right? And that's where we have the runtime. It's the compute. It's where you're running that code that you've built in your agent, whether you've built it with strands or with LangChain or whatever SDK, you've written your own code. AgentCore runtime is the serverless compute that is the core of where you run your agents. And then there is AgentCore gateway, which is, hey, I want to connect to my other services. I want to connect to my data estate. I want to connect in tools via MCP. I want to connect those all into a single point where I can monitor them and govern them and so on. And we have AgentCore memory, which is this kind of short-lived state primitive and the place where agents remember facts about users and facts about the work that they're doing. The simplest version of that is user preferences. You say to the agent, you know, I like, you know, meetings in the early morning. It's going to write that down. It's going to remember it for you so you don't have to, you know, tell it every time. There's AgentCore observability that plugs into CloudWatch. It plugs into, you know, the rest of AWS's observability services to make it so you can monitor those agents, know what they're doing, trace their execution. And then first-party tools, right? Yeah. The AgentCore web use tool where you can, you know, not everything is accessible as a nice API, right? Some things are hidden behind websites. How do we do that? Well, we use another model to go and click on those websites, get the data, build automation around those sort of through the web. And then the code interpreter tool, which is this really emerging pattern where instead of agents doing everything, you know, by going through the LLM every time, we can do this much more efficient path of get the agent to write some code, and then use that code to do the heavy lifting of calling tools and summarizing data and so on. And then when there are sort of these open-ended, flexible things to do, you can go back to the model and spend the tokens, you can spend the time, and have the model make those sort of higher-level decisions rather than the byte-by-byte decisions.
So the AgentCore is the console, basically, for agents.
AgentCore is the console for agents. So it's the core building block. But then you can bring in anything else in AWS, or anything else outside AWS, right? There are open protocols like MCP that allow you to connect to, you know, wherever your data is, whether it's in AWS, whether it's in one of our database services, whether it's in S3, or in a third-party software as a service.
So the things I wrote down to ask you about was the infrastructure, AgentCore. Thanks for mentioning that. The runtime and safety architecture, because everyone's like chirping about safety.
Yeah,
it's off the rails. It's hallucinating. Agents have to be, you know, SLA compliant. So there's a lot of governance built into this. What, talk about the runtime, because essentially agents are like apps. You're basically building kind of like an app, if you will. So, and that's not my view. Take me through the safety piece, the runtime. It's executing things.
Mm-hmm. It's executing code.
It's like I don't want to go get root access somewhere. Right. So there's all this. I know you guys think a lot about this.
Yeah, we sure do. And I, you know, this is you started the early days of EC2. You know, we were building these virtual machines for customers, and then over time we built those virtual machines, you know, new ways that are smaller and finer grained while still offering, you know, the same great security. And so, if you look at AgentCore, every time you run your agent, every time you have a new session with an agent, a new conversation with an agent, it gets its own virtual machine, gets its own strong security boundary where that session with an agent runs. And what's great about that is that there's a huge amount of trust built in, right? You can say to, you know, that agent, I'm going to give it my credentials, I'm going to give it that user's credentials. It can use those credentials to call those third-party tools. It doesn't have access to anything else. It doesn't have access to any data beyond those, you know, beyond what that user has. It doesn't have access to other tools. It can't write things down in a way that persists. Mm-hmm. And so you can kind of build this box around your agent where using tools like the AgentCore Gateway really limit what an agent can do. Using tools like Bedrock Guardrails limit what an agent can say. And then once you have those, well, the code running inside the box, you don't really care about it as much, right? It can't have any side effects. And so what you have to worry about is instead of that security, we're taking care of that with virtualization and these very secure machine boundaries. Instead of that, you need to worry about what can this agent do and what can this agent say? And those are specific to your business, right? What can do, what data can it access, what tools can it access, can it book air tickets, yes or no? Those are the kinds of non-infrastructure decisions that you build into something like AgentCore.
And you guys enable that. You have the capability
to enable that.
But,
right.
And you get, as it gets smarter,
yeah,
it's going to get better. You've been at Amazon for how many years?
Since 2008, so 17 and a bit years.
Yeah. We've been covering reInvent. This is, I think, our 12th year, maybe. It gets better every year. I want to ask you about the culture, because you mentioned EC2. That was one of the, you know, one of the key products. As you look at the culture today at AWS, what you guys are building, how would you talk about it in the AI kind of side of the way? I mean, in the pre-AI, it was, you know, building blocks, primitives, higher level services, and then app built on top ecosystem.
Yeah, right.
Is it the same? How would you describe, because in a way, you're almost abstracting away the old AWS or the previous current AWS and building a whole nother level of services, of infrastructure-like capabilities, almost like a new stack on top of that. Right. Or how would you describe it? I'm kind of
bummed. Maybe I'd go even further back. If you look at this whole arc of the history of computing, there's been this sort of constantly rising level of abstraction, right? I used to worry about machine code and assembly language and physical addresses and, you know, bits and bytes of memory. Most developers aren't worrying about those things and haven't worried about those things for 30 plus years. And so, you know, then we had the cloud, this great abstraction. You don't build your own data centers anymore. You don't rack and stack your own servers, right? And that brought a huge amount of value. And then, you know, serverless. I'm not patching my own kernel anymore. I'm not, you know, configuring instances. I'm not managing threads anymore. And so that continuing growth, and AI is kind of the next step there, right? And so if you look at something like Kiro, I can build an application without getting into the code level necessarily, right? I can talk about my business requirements. I can talk about my specification. I can bring that into AgentCore and, you know, have all of the infrastructure.
You're a product manager at that point. You're a product manager at that point.
Yeah,
kind of.
More and more. But, I think it is still, you know, this core engineering discipline, which has always been, you know, how do I solve problems for my customers and my business using technology? And now, well, it's exciting because suddenly I have more power to do that.
Okay, so question for you, because, I mean, you put up two things I wanted to touch on. Maybe we can probably come and do a follow-up on, but distributed computing paradigm has been around and continues to be kind of a computer science principle. That's, you know, cloud and edge and everything in between. That will continue to abstract away. And then you mentioned engineering. Software engineering was the degree I got.
Right.
It's called software engineering, not developer. It was engineering. So how would you describe the engineering work involved with Kiro and all these fun tools that make it easier to do, you know, crafty, cool, artisan-like coding to full engineering? What is the engineering discipline required in this era? Is it system thinking around consequences? How would you frame that? And really, no one's really talked about this, but I've been, you know, we're seeing the systems thinking coming back.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, we're in a systems world.
Right.
It's just easy to code.
Yep.
Now, you assume there's the worker bees and the agents behind the scenes making it happen. What is the system architecture thinking that engineers will engineer? What's your view on that?
So if you think about what is the work of software engineering, right, it has always been a mix of the essential complexity of building things. What am I building? What are the requirements? What does correct mean? What does secure mean? And then this inessential complexity of what is the right syntax for that SQL query? It matters only because it's an implementation detail, but it doesn't really matter to the outcome. And so as we've gone up the levels with things like Kiro's spec-driven development, we're getting closer to that essential complexity of what does correct mean? What does it mean for this application to do the right thing?
Versus,
right?
Say, syntax.
Versus syntax, which ultimately, I mean, as
in the old days, you get a compiler error. Right. Didn't compile.
Yeah.
Go back and fix the code.
Right.
A syntax error.
Yeah, which, you know, yeah. I mean, fundamentally, at some level, doesn't matter.
Yeah.
And what matters is the specification. And so you can see that with Kiro spec-driven development. You can see that with property-based testing that came in the Kiro GA last week, where, you know, now Kiro can generate these tests that go off and generate huge numbers of their own test cases that can run against that specification and say, is this code right? And then you get that systems thinking of, you know, not how do I move the bits and bytes to do this, but, you know, is this a database? Yeah. Is this a queue? How long should this data be there? How should this data be accessible? How should this data be access controlled? And so we sort of bring up this level of abstraction, but the core engineering principles haven't changed. It's about solving problems, and it's about
and agentic brings in, you know, new levels of engineering tasks like
Right.
What's the workflow look like? It's now going to have multiple dimensions of connections.
Yep.
I mean, it's still a large scale problem. In fact, all the AI examples I've been following, there's more complexity because there's more things being automated.
Right, and there's more dynamism. And that is something that we are all learning as an industry to handle.
And autonomous makes this even more challenging to run autonomous anything. Everyone thinks about a car or a robo-taxi.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, that complexity, that was engineered, clearly. And autonomous is going to be part of agentic. What's your view on autonomous agents? That's an engineering challenge.
And it really is. And that's where you get into the, what are the bounds of what this agent can do, right? Hey, I want this agent to go off and book a trip for me. When you say that, you don't mean open-ended. You're going to give it a budget. You're going to give it a time frame. You're going to have these requirements as an end user. And then the infrastructure can enforce that everything the agent does is within the box set by those requirements. If you say, my budget is $1,000, well, we can enforce at the infrastructure level that agent doesn't spend more than $1,000, with these boundaries like the agent core gateway. And then you can give the agents a ton of autonomy because you've said, don't go outside this box, but within this box, be as creative as possible.
Marc, thanks for spending the time and sharing all that data with us on theCUBE. Final question for folks, going to hear a lot at reInvent on this, agents and the news. Going into 2026, what do you think are the most important things people should pay attention to and some things that they should pay attention to that no one will talk about? So the most important stories and issues, and what's the outlier that might emerge? I mean, MCP came out of the woodwork.
Yeah.
That was a beautiful thing. What is going to be the top story, and then what's going to emerge?
I think the two big things that are happening there. One of them is an emerging understanding of the importance of agent ops, right? This ability to understand all of the agents in my organization. What are they doing? How are they spending my money? How are they spending those tokens? What is the ROI there? Are they having, are they having success? And I think what we're going to see next year is a ton more organizations getting good at that process, right? Mm-hmm. You've built a ton of agents. How should you think about, how they run? And then the other one, and you talked about MCP and its sudden emergence. Well, MCP is great, right? It's caused this explosion in tool use in the agent ecosystem. But it's also not particularly scalable. If I have, 100 databases or 100 tools, 1,000 tools, MCP doesn't scale super well. And so I think the other big trend next year is going to be ways for agents to access their environment that are more scalable than MCP, maybe more governable than MCP. And maybe we'll still call those things MCP, and they will be an evolution of the protocol that we know and love today.
And the scale is the key there, and right. Intelligence, knowledge.
Right.
Thanks for coming on theCUBE. Appreciate it. All right, great
chat.
Thank
you so much.
We can do a deep dive another time. We can do an hour on this. I'm John Furrier here at theCUBE at AWS's headquarters at the reInvent building on the reInvent preview. Coming up, of course, agents are the future. They're going to build on top of the large-scale infrastructure, the AI factories, and certainly at the edge. They're going to follow us all around and be part of our lives. Thanks for watching.